Hello everyone and welcome to Sengupta Research Academy. We've been in the past lecture we've looked at the building blocks for statistics of what a variable really means. In today's class what we'll look at is how do you really capture that variable, how do you put that variable on your computer or on your paper and then do statistics with it. So what we're going to look at is data entry formats and most importantly how to make an Excel sheet. That's what we're going to do in this lecture. So essentially we'll look at how to make an Excel sheet into this class. So there are many different data entry formats. Excel is very easily available format, pretty much available on most computers, and that is what is most commonly used. However, we should also remember that there are different ways of entering data in addition to Excel, like Microsoft Access, like Notepad, like directly into statistics software packages like Stata and SPSS, or also as a CSV file or comma separated variable. So these are other forms of data entry, but we'll concentrate ourselves on how to make an Excel sheet. So the real aim of preparing a data sheet or an Excel sheet is ease to import the Excel sheet into a statistical software package. We should understand that statistics are done using specific softwares, for example Stata, SPSS, SAS, you may have heard about these. So these will import data from Excel and then they will help us analyze the data, right? So preparing an Excel sheet should follow certain basic rules so that it becomes very easy for us to import data into Stata or SPSS. And I can tell you from experience is that maximum time is spent by a statistician importing data and putting it in place rather than actually analyzing data. So if you make an Excel sheet well, it really fast forwards the way a statistician looks at your Excel. He's impressed by the Excel, he performs statistics quickly, and you may actually reduce the time that the statistician takes by half. So it's very important to make the Excel sheet properly. So like I'm reiterating, your goal should be to create a machine readable file, that can be read into your preferred statistical software package. So machine readable file is very, very important. This is an example of the software package that I use, that is called Stata, S-T-A-T-A. And this is the sort of, screenshot of the package that I use. So what we do is, we go to file and I say import, and you can import data in different formats. The first of that is called Excel. So when I say press Excel sheet, this is what I see. I can actually browse and select that Excel sheet, and then this is really the interface that I see. And when I say import, this is, as you can see on the right side of the page, all your variables have actually got imported and the data has actually come into the Stata software package, right? So if the data is well organized, then it's very easy for me like this to quickly import data into Stata. So there are certain conventions, like I was saying, that have to be followed to make the Excel sheet in a proper way. The statistical software packages recognize data as numericals, that is as numbers, or strings, that is alphabets. So whatever numbers are there in your Excel will be looked at as numericals, and whatever alphabets that you use are going to be looked as strings. Remember that only numerical data or numbers can be analyzed. Alphabets cannot be analyzed. So if you in an Excel sheet write, for example, age as 5 years, Y-E-A-R-S, then it becomes a string variable or it becomes an alphabetical variable, the entire thing. And that cannot be utilized by the statistical software package. So most important to remember is that except for the top row, what you have to put on the Excel is only numericals. There is no space or there is no scope of adding any alphabets there, right? That is the first thumb rule, that it should only be numericals and no alphabets. Then conventions to be followed. So when you're like, what is a continuous and what is a categorical variable. So continuous variables, you enter as such and use the same unit consistently. So if you say follow up in days, you keep all those follow up in days and you don't keep writing DAYS all the time. If you say follow up in months, you keep the same unit all the time. So entire column of continuous variables should have the same unit. That is the thumb rule for continuous variables. Alright, coming to categorical variables, you will assign it numbers, right? 0, 1, 2, 3. So it is a convention to start from 0 and not from 1. For example, if you want to do males and females, you will say male as 0 and female as 1. So make it a point to start from 0 and which should get 0 and which should get 1. Think about the comparison group. So if you want to say, Avastin versus Lucentis versus IVTA, if you say I want to compare my results with respect to Avastin, then Avastin becomes 0. If you want to say I want to compare my results with IVTA or for example laser versus Avastin versus IVTA, then laser is a comparison group here, so that becomes 0. So start with 0 and not with 1. So put each individual variable that you have measured in separate columns. For example, age and gender are two separate variables. So put one column for age and enter all the numbers as in years or in months or whatever. And then in the next column should be the gender, or then you enter either as 0 and 1, that is either male or female. So separate columns for separate variables and separate rows for separate patients. Each patient should have one row, right? Now in ophthalmology, we have data from both eyes, that is right eye and left eye. So it is advisable that you have each one row for right eye and then a separate row for left eye, in which case the name of the patient remains the same and the MRD number remains the same. But then we know that it has a right eye and a left eye. So there are different columns, different rows for right eye and left eye. So that is usually convention that we follow in ophthalmology. Only the first row should contain variable names. That's the other thumb rule. Do not include variable names in the second row. This is an example of what should not be done. As you can see, the first row has just said OCT variables, and then you have OCT at baseline and 1 month, etc. The right way is to do this. So have the variable names only on the first row, not the second, third or fourth rows. That cannot be really consumed by the statistical analysis software that I showed you. Then a variable name should be chosen very carefully. It should be recognizable name for the variable that you have chosen, but not too long or not too short. Roughly 10 to 16 characters is the maximum that a variable name should be. If you have variable, the name has two words, so they separate the two words with a hyphen, or an underscore. Never put space between letters when you're labeling the variable. Never use any special characters such as @ or hashtags, etc. And for example, if you have OCT at baseline and then at visit 1, 3 and 6 months, what you can do is you can say OCT underscore baseline. Then the next column will be OCT underscore 1 month. Then at next column will be OCT underscore 3 months, something like that. Then you need to label each and every variable that is there. So to label the variable, you can add a comment on Excel. This is how you do it. You need to right click on the box of interest, and then you scroll down, you will see insert comment. When you press insert comment, a blank box opens up, and then you can say, for example, OCT at baseline was central subfoveal thickness at baseline in microns, for example. You label it appropriately. Once you label variables, you will see a small red dot at the right hand top corner of the box for the variable, like this, and that means that box has a comment to it. Always maintain a separate code book, what is called a code book. That is, maintain a separate file that is numbers assigned to each category and the expanded meaning of each short variable name. So OCT underscore baseline, you can add in the code book OCT at baseline. Then you say OCT underscore 1 month, where you say OCT at 1 month in microns. This can be maintained in adjacent Excel or a Word document just for your record and backup. It is not a must, but it is a good idea to maintain that. This is called a code book. This is a template that you can use, where you say the variable name, the data type, either numerical or categorical, then the description of actually what the data is recording, then codes, if any, that you've used, for example, 0 is laser, 1 is IVT and 2 is Avastin, and then any comments if you might want to have there. The next thumb rule is to de-identify your data, especially when you are going to share your data with somebody outside your institution. You don't really want your patient to be tracked back in some form or another. So it's a good idea to send de-identified data. So there should not be any patient identifiers in that Excel sheet. For example, patient name or patient MR number should not be part of the Excel sheet. However, each row should have a separate identifier. A simple way of doing is just write serial number 1, 2, 3, 4, and you maintain the Excel at the back end, which says serial number 1 means which patient, serial number 2 means actually which patient, or 3 means actually which patient. So that is how you can de-identify data. The other thumb rule is, try and avoid making multiple Excel sheets for the same study. For example, data for laser group, data for IVTA group and data for Avastin group. You don't want to make 3 separate Excel sheets for all of these. As far as possible, try and maintain one Excel sheet for all of these. You can have a column which says intervention, and you can say 0 is 1, 0 is laser, 1 is IVTA and 2 is Avastin. So that is how you can make all of that into one Excel sheet. Making multiple Excel sheets sometimes may be important. If it's a retrospective data of say 6,000 patients, then you may want to split it into 6 individuals who will be making the same Excel sheet. So make sure that the same Excel sheet is designed and the same Excel sheet is actually being populated by everyone. And definitely make sure that each individual patient has a separate identifier, like a serial number or MR number or whatever you might want to keep. So if you have the same columns, exactly the same columns in 3 or 4 Excel sheets, then that can be merged easily, specifically based on based on most importantly the serial number or the single patient identifier. So it's a good idea to make the Excel sheet and use the same sheet for data entry by multiple users, like I said. The next thumb rule is that there should be only one entry in each box. You know, this is an example of an Excel sheet for ocular trauma, which says injury and which has been labeled as 1 is high femur, 2 is traumatic cataract, 3 is Berlin's edema, 4 is submacular hemorrhage, and 5th is choroidal rupture. For example, this is just an example. And then, you know, it's possible that one patient may have multiple manifestations. So, for example, the first patient had 1, 2, and 4. The second patient had 1, 3, and 5. So, it has been entered as 1, 3, 5 or 1, 2, 4. Now, this sort of entry in an Excel sheet cannot be utilized by the statistical software package. So, think about it. If a particular patient or an eye is likely to have multiple entries in each cell, then better to separate these out. Where you say high femur, yes, no. Then you say the next column or next variable can be traumatic cataract, where again you say yes, no. Then you say Berlin's edema, yes, no. Submacular hemorrhage, yes, no. And choroidal rupture, yes, no. So include a separate column for each and you can add yes, no in that manner. The other thumb rule is avoid using special Excel features like hidden columns, graphs on the data sheet that is in your primary database, colors, italics, bold, you know, these don't really help too much. Having graphs or hidden columns, the column will always remain hidden. And then, you know, we may not even, so that variable really appears as if it has never been calculated or never been captured. So do not use, hidden columns and graphs on the same Excel sheet. The next thumb rule is missing data. You know, what do you really do with missing data? Do you really leave it blank or do you add a value to that, right? So, because if you leave it blank, the statistical software assigns a category if it's a categorical variable, you know. So, if you say male is 0 and female is 1 and you've actually forgotten to enter something in that box, if it remains blank, then sometimes statistical software package may actually assign it arbitrarily to 0, you know, or to the lowest value. So, then, you know, do not leave any cells completely blank. The best practice is to assign a dot. So, you put a dot to the missed data point in a continuous variable. In continuous variable, and you can assign some arbitrary number like 999, for example, into, you know, or any other improbable number to the missed variable in a categorical value. So if you say 0, 1, and 2, if it says 999, that means it's missing, right? Because I mean, you don't have information about that. So treat missing data like that. In a continuous variable, put it as a full stop or a dot, and a continuous variable, add an improbable number. And clearly communicate this to your statistician when you're actually sending the Excel sheet out. So in summary, these are the sort of thumb rules: is only numbers, no alphabets except for the first row. Maintain consistency in units for the continuous variables. In the categorical variables, choose the comparison group as 0. Variables in columns and observations in rows. Left and right eye in separate rows, which is very important if you want to analyze them separately. Variable names in the first row only. Label variables as comments and maintain a codebook if possible. And maintain only one Excel sheet as far as possible. Only one entry in one cell and never as A, B, and C. And no special features like hiding a column, etc. And you deal with missing data by using dots for continuous variables and an improbable number like 999 for categorical variables. Using these thumb rules, you will, I'm sure, benefit and your Excel sheet will become much better. And statisticians will, you know, really be impressed at the way you send your Excel sheet. Thank you.